Welcome back, cadets. I am Professor Eclipse, and when I was growing up, there was a small handful of franchises that really resonated with me and helped to curate my taste for all things nerdy. One of the biggest was Ghostbusters. The movie was truly a lightning-in-a-bottle situation for Columbia Pictures. The cast, the story, the effects, everything came together in the Goldilocks kind of way where everything was just right. The film was able to somehow perfectly blend science fiction, comedy, and horror all into one film without any of the elements overshining the others. And I don't think there's ever been another film series that's ever even been able to come close to replicating what Ghostbusters has been able to do. And with Ghostbusters Frozen Empire just a couple weeks away, I want to delve into this franchise and discuss each film in the soon-to-be quadrilogy. Ghostbusters begins with a cold open set at the New York Public Library, with an old librarian taking a couple books down to the lower floors. It's not long before something strange begins to happen in the neighborhood, though. Books float from shelf to shelf. The Dewey Decimal card system is utterly ramshackled, which naturally causes the dear old librarian to freak out. She makes a run for it, but comes into contact with an unseen ghost leading to our title card. We then meet Peter Venkman, played by Bill Murray. This initial meeting shows us exactly the type of character Venkman is. He's, for all intents and purposes, kind of a sleazeball. Venkman is a college professor working at Columbia University, studying the effects of negative reinforcement on psychic abilities. The funny part, though, is that if Venkman took his own study even remotely seriously, he would have seen that his tests were resulting in a stronger ESP response from the guy that he kept shocking. Instead, he was more focused on flirting with the young college co-ed. Ray Stantz then bursts into the office, ruining Venkman's attempts to seduce the young woman. Ray Stantz was played by Dan Aykroyd, who was originally the one who came up with the concept of Ghostbusters. Initially, the idea was much more out there than the semi-grounded films we ended up with. When Aykroyd was originally developing the concept, Ghostbusters leaned much more into its science fiction roots. The team was from the future and could travel between dimensions. Luckily, Harold Ramis was brought in to work with Aykroyd, and he was able to help steer the story into what it became. They go to the library to meet up with Egon Spengler, played by Harold Ramis himself, and the trio make their first contact with a real ghost. Initially known simply as the Library Ghost, or the Grey Lady, she was later given a fleshed-out backstory and the name Eleanor Twitty in the 2009 Ghostbusters the video game. The group attempts to make contact with the library ghost, but all she wants to do is read her book in peace. Eventually, she gets angry enough to scare the boys out of the library after Ray decides that the best course of action is to try and get her. The encounter wasn't totally in vain, though. The information that Spengler was able to gather via the PKE meter was enough to give him confidence that they would be able to capture a ghost and contain it indefinitely. Unfortunately, once they make it back to campus, they are met by the dean of the college, who informs them that their grant has been terminated and they are fired. Venkman, being a man of opportunity, suggests that they should go into business for themselves and convinces Ray to take out a whopping 3 mortgages on his home that was left to him by his parents in order for them to have enough cash to start up the business. With their newly acquired startup cash, they are able to purchase the Hook and Ladder 8 firehouse, develop their equipment, get their company car, and create a commercial for their business. It's a bit of a tangent, but it's amazing to me that in 1984, Bill Murray was only 33 and Dan Aykroyd was only 31. Even back then, they looked like they were at least in their mid-40s. People these days really don't seem to age the same way that they did back then. Anyway, we're then introduced to Dana Barrett, played by Sigourney Weaver. She lives in an apartment in Central Park West. She initially is greeted by her neighbor Louis Tully, played by Rick Moranis. It's pretty clear early on that he has a major crush on his neighbor, and it just seems like Dana kinda realizes this, but doesn't feel the same way. I should say here, too, that it's an ongoing joke throughout the film that Lewis always winds up locking himself out of his apartment, despite eventually being possessed and becoming the Keymaster. I'm sure that they knew what they were doing when they were making that joke, and it's just one of those things that are just so subtle, and it really, really just makes the film. Dana makes it into her apartment and sees the Ghostbusters commercial in passing as she puts away her groceries. While doing so, her counter decides to become a haunted hibachi and cooks her eggs over easy. Just the way I like them. She then hears a sound coming from a refrigerator and is met with a demonic beast who calls her Zool.
She makes her way to the Ghostbusters firehouse and is met by Venkman, who immediately goes into his flirty sleazeball routine with her. Ray and Egon ask questions, and Peter suggests that he go back to Dana's apartment and check her out. They do so, and while half-heartedly looking for ghost activity, he mostly opts to just flirt with Dana further. She doesn't seem to be that interested, and once Venkman suggests that he's not getting any reading on his equipment, he's asked to leave. He makes one more attempt to make a come on before he finally gets his face shoved out the door. After all of this setup, we make it to the first official ghost-busting job. The Ghostbusters receive their first call, and we see the first appearance of the Ecto-1 in all of its glory, as well as the jumpsuits and proton packs. They're called to the Sedgwick Hotel, where they come face-to-face with the onion-headed ghost of John Belushi himself, Slimer. Slimer wound up becoming a major mascot for the franchise, especially once the real Ghostbusters cartoon series began airing and captured the imagination of children everywhere, myself included. They wind up capturing Slimer in the Sedgwick Ballroom and then grift the hotel manager out of $5,000. This is one of those ironic parts of Ghostbusters for me, because later in the film, Walter Peck suggests that they are con artists who use nerve gases to convince people that they're seeing ghosts. And Peck is right, in a way. They are con artists, but the con is really just what they're charging, since the price seems to be largely just based on whatever they need to keep the business afloat. It's also at this point in the film that we are introduced to the Chekhov's gun of the Ghostbusters franchise, crossing the streams. It would be bad. Try to imagine all life as you know it stopping instantaneously and every molecule in your body exploding at the speed of light. That's bad. And an important safety tip. The capture of Slimer leads to a montage that shows the Ghostbusters becoming well-known throughout New York. This is also where they wind up using some of the footage that they filmed for other scenes that didn't quite make the cut, like the scene where Ray is getting, intimate with a ghost lady. With as busy as the Ghostbusters have become, they opt to hire in their fourth and final member of the team for the film, Winston Zeddemore, played by Ernie Hudson. Originally, Zeddemore had a much larger role in the film and was supposed to arrive about 20 minutes into the movie, but that was also when the character was supposed to be played by Eddie Murphy, but he had to pass on the film to his role in Beverly Hills Cop, which released the same year. When Murphy passed on the film, the role was cut down quite a bit, and many of the lines that would have been given to him were instead given to Bill Murray, as the team felt that his star power at the time would be a big draw for people to come watch the movie. Ernie Hudson's always gotten the short end of the Neutrona wand when it comes to this series. When casting for the real Ghostbusters cartoon, he was originally supposed to be reprising his own role, but he was turned down by the casting director of the series because in the audition, he apparently didn't sound enough like Winston Zeddemore. On top of that, even to this day, so many of the promotional materials for the movie just has the original trio leaving Winston out. Personally, I'm really glad that this has been rectified between Ghostbusters Afterlife and Frozen Empire. Out of all of them, his character was the one to find actual career success. Dana comes back into the picture for a scene when Venkman gives her more information on her case and invites her out on a date, which she agrees to for some reason. We then officially meet Walter Peck, the main human antagonist of the Ghostbusters. Venkman and Peck get off to a bad start due to Venkman's desire to be a smartass rather than just play ball. Let's ignore the fact that the Ghostbusters are ultimately the good guys for a second. Walter Peck really isn't wrong. There's absolutely no oversight for the Ghostbusters, and they're literally walking around with micro hadron colliders on their backs. Meanwhile, Egon, Ray, and Winston are in the basement. Ray is teaching Winston the ropes of ghostbusting, and Egon is explaining that the most recent PKE reading suggests that something big is about to happen. That big something is happening at Dana's apartment building. The dog statues on the roof break open and come to life. Dana is getting ready for a date with Peter when she notices her door acting a bit like the Nightmare on Elm Street. She's met by a terror dog, which possesses her and turns her into the gatekeeper. Her neighbor Lewis is also throwing his party while this is going on, and another terror dog manages to chase him down and possess him as well, which turns him into the keymaster. Peter shows up for his date and is met by the gatekeeper. He proceeds to knock her out with Thorazine, which seems more than a bit sketchy if you think about it for more than a couple seconds. Meanwhile, the NYPD has collected the Keymaster and taken him to Ghostbusters Firehouse because they don't really know what to do with him, they don't want to throw him in jail, and they just want to see kind of what's going on. Egon scans him with his PKE meter and it immediately jumps off the scale, so he takes him inside to conduct more tests. Peter gets in touch with Egon and lets him know what's happened to Dana before leaving her in her apartment to meet up with the others and discuss their next steps. We also see that Ray and Winston are coming back from a case of some sort and discussing religion, and that maybe the reason they're so busy is because the dead have been rising from the grave, in preparation for Judgment Day. Before they can make it back to the firehouse, though, Walter Peck returns with police and a representative from the power company with a court order to shut down their business, starting with the containment unit. Despite Egon and Peter's warnings, the protection grid is shut down, causing an explosion that blows the roof off the firehouse and releases every ghost that the team has captured up until that point. The Keymaster manages to escape, and the Ghostbusters are arrested. While in jail, they're given time to exposit on Dana's apartment building and how it was built by a cultist named Evo Shandor, who is a worshipper of Gozer. The building was built using selenium girders, which act as a sort of spiritual antenna to bring Gozer to their plane of existence, and it looks like that is about to happen. The Ghostbusters are then taken to the mayor's office, where they attempt to explain what's happening. Ultimately, Venkman rolls a successful charisma skill check and convinces the mayor that if he backs them and they save the city, then he will be responsible for having saved the lives of millions of registered voters. With the full backing of the National Guard and the NYPD, the Ghostbusters drive the Ecto-1 through the city towards the Shandor building. Unfortunately, once they get there, they're almost immediately buried alive, but they manage to make it out and begin the long, daunting climb up to Dana's apartment. I can only imagine what a pain that would have been. Had it been real, proton packs are not light by any stretch of the imagination. The prop in the film weighed about 35 pounds, and they were a constant source of back pain for the team due to the long filming days where they had to be fully suited up with all their gear. They do make it to the top of the Shandor building just in time to see the gatekeeper and the Keymaster turn into terror dogs, opening the gateway for Gozer to come through. At this point, we meet the big bad of the film, Gozer the Gozerian, Gozer the Traveler, Gozer the Destructor. Ray is voted to be the one to make contact with the deity of destruction, and Gozer asks him, "Are you a god?" Now, as we all know, if somebody asks you if you're a god, you say yes. Unfortunately, Ray didn't get the memo, so Gozer attempts to unalive them. The Ghostbusters survive the first attack and attempt to fire back. Gozer disappears, and at first they think they've beaten the god, but readings that Egon takes suggest that things are about to get worse. The disembodied voice of Gozer demands that they choose the form of the Destructor. It's explained that the first thing that they think of is what Gozer will take the form of and destroy them along with the rest of the world. Gozer then claims that the choice has been made, and Ray apologizes because the Destructor form is revealed to have come from his mind. It's explained in the IDW comic series that Ray was really the only one that Gozer was speaking to directly, and that the other Ghostbusters were thinking of things despite claiming that their minds were empty, which I thought was a nice explanation for things because realistically, if Gozer was asking all of them, it would have become J. Edgar Hoover in the moment that Venkman explained how he thought it worked. Anyway, Ray chose the form of the Stay Puffed Marshmallow Man, the mascot of the marshmallows that he would roast by the fire when he was a kid while at summer camp. This particular version of Stay Puffed is kaiju-sized, though, and stomps through the city, heading directly for the Ghostbusters. With no other ideas, Egon suggests that they use the Chekhov's gun and cross the streams through the gateway in order to reverse the polarity and close it. The others reluctantly agree, and they do the unthinkable, blowing up the gateway and the Stay Puffed Marshmallow Man in the process. At first, they think Dana and Lewis were killed in the explosion due to the terror dogs having reverted to burnt statues, but after seeing movement, they get both of them out of their dog suits, and the day is saved. The Ghostbusters head back down the massive flight of stairs and are greeted by a mass of supporters thanking them for saving the world, and then they pack up their gear, get back in the Ecto-1, and drive off, ending the film.
Like I said at the beginning of the video, Ghostbusters truly was a lightning-in-a-bottle kind of film. It managed to balance science fiction, comedy, and horror while simultaneously being a movie for adults that found a massive audience with children that led to an animated series, countless action figures, and a relatively small but strongly devout fan base. At every convention I've ever been to, there's been no less than a dozen Ghostbusters wearing their jumpsuits and proton packs, living their best lives while raising money for a number of charities. So their love of Ghostbusters can somehow help other people that are in need. Ghostbusters was a massive part of my childhood. I was born just a few months before Ghostbusters 2 came out, and the animated series ended when I was a baby. But the cartoon played on Saturday mornings for years afterwards, which is how I first fell in love with the series. The toys, unfortunately, were long out of stores by the time I was old enough to actually want them, so the only way I was able to get anything back then was by finding things at yard sales and thrift stores. Thankfully, nowadays, there are companies out there willing to make props and toys from properties from our childhoods. I never thought I would have a full-size replica proton pack with the lights and sounds, but I fucking do, and it's awesome. Anyway, if you like this video, be sure to hit that like button, and if you want to see more content like this, go ahead and follow me so you'll know when those new uploads come. And be sure to check back, because in the next video, I'm going to be taking a look at the 1989 sequel, Ghostbusters 2. But until then, this is Professor Eclipse, signing off.